Good evening. I'm Vicki Berry, I'm the director of the OSU Museum of Art, and I'm here with my colleagues Carrie Kim and Casey Pinky and back there to welcome you, and it's my pleasure to introduce our guest artist this evening. This starts out an incredible series of programs for an exhibition called From the Belly of Our Being, Art By and About Native Creation. So you're the first. We do indeed need to expand and make you aware that this project has been funded by some wonderful people, the National Endowment for the Arts, the Arts Council, Janine and Ron Halsey, Marianne and Ken Ferguson, and the Chickasaw Nation, who made the exhibition and a wonderful catalog that you can expect later in October to see, very possible for all of us to enjoy, and they will be free and available to we encourage you, just to note that I know you have a faculty exhibition opening tomorrow evening, or Wednesday evening, and in addition to that, then Thursday evening, our guest curator here at the town is going to be a presentation at 6 o'clock at the museum. So we encourage you to come listen to her. We are going to do what you're doing, which is videotaping her. So if you miss it, we'll have that some available at some point in the future. So see Maxx Stevens, as her slide tells you her name, she's an installation artist and a member of the Seminole Muscogee Nation. Was born in, I'm going to say Miwaka, is that correct? Is it Miwaka, Oklahoma? Okay. And she grew up in Wichita, Kansas. She's an assistant professor of art, so she knows about schools, and teaches in the foundation program and in the art and art history department at the University of Colorado in Boulder. From 2002 to 2005, CMAX served as an academic dean in the Center for Arts and Cultural Studies at the Institute of American Indian Arts in Santa Fe, New Mexico. She received her Master of Fine Arts in 1987 from Indiana University, Bloomington, Indiana, and her Bachelor of Fine Arts in 1979 from Wichita State University, Wichita, Kansas. And in 1972, her Associate of Arts from Haskell Junior College in Lawrence, Kansas. She's been the recipient of many awards and honors, such as the 2005 Adelgerbe Fellowship Award from the Adelgerbe Museum in Indianapolis, Indiana, the 2000 Artist Grant from the Andrea Frank Foundation in New York, and a 1998 Sculpture Award from the Joan Mitchell Foundation in New York. She's also exhibited at the Adelgerbe at the Museum of Arts and Design in New York and the Smithsonian Museum of Indian Art, and now the OSU Museum of Art. I hope you'll enjoy her presentation this evening and join us to see her installation at the museum, which she did specifically for this exhibition. She's a visual storyteller whose deeply personal and eclectic constructions tell stories about places and people from her past. Working with found objects and ephemeral materials such as paper, wood, and hair, her art has a dark, gritty quality that is both haunting and familiar. The selected installation is in the exhibition addresses memory through cultural and personal symbols and illustrates the complexities of the contemporary Native experience. Please welcome C. Maxx Stevens.
Storytelling, because that's my visual storytelling, because that's generally how I operate and how I work with my materials, my work as a contemporary Native artist tries to create a place for ideals and questions of life. How do we as indigenous people perceive who we are and how are we influenced and changed by those perceptions? So we're going to go through a lot of different things with my work. I decided not to just go from one show to next show to next show, but I wanted to talk more about my concepts and how I got my ideas, my creative process. Okay, my artwork is shaped by who I am as an indigenous person, a member of the Seminole and Skagit tribe nations, and as a Native woman living in a contemporary society. I am consciously aware to remain true to my cultural heritage and my sense of self. Memories and issues from my personal experience, specifically my life within the Native American culture, are my starting point. From there, I weave together Native parts, creating a stream of wordplay, installations, sculpture, prints, and digital media. Today, I did a lot of talking about how my method and how words are pretty important in my work, not so much as in the final piece, but as the beginning point. It's like I start brainstorming, trying to figure out what exactly am I going to be doing. And from there, different concepts into my pieces. This is a piece called Constant Rotation, House of Constant Rotation at the Smithsonian. And it's kind of dealing with the dualism that we all kind of deal with. We have a good side, we have a bad side, we have a past and a future. And we learn to embrace these elements in order to live. So I use these dualistic combinations, as well as memories, my cultural landscape, and my personal history to develop a concept for my art. My focus has evolved from examining the ways that contemporary events and political issues have influenced many traditions in the Native culture. My examination raises many questions for me about who I am as a person. And in this piece, it has this bird, and he's on a turntable, a record player. So my method of working is, I like to use low-tech, things I kind of experience in life. So when the piece is on, the bird turns and turns. And when I showed you the piece, here, it has this image of me being in my traditional kind of Seminole skirt, but I also have a picture of me on the other side, because generally, well, I used to dress more in black, and so there was like that black side, and then the traditional side, so contemporary tradition. And what the bird did, the crow, as it turned on the turntable table, it would, I have this image floating. I have this image floating, hanging in the birdcage. So every time the bird would come around, it was like pecking me. So it was kind of like a reminder of who I am and what I do. Mm-hmm. concepts. The focus leads originally organically and to how I determine materials and technology for my work. My work and process begins with free-form writing. Then I associate these concepts with objects and or technologies using their site-specific locations to create an installation that hopefully resonates with the viewer. Then I associate these concepts with objects of technology. Oh, I just said that. I use space and materials together to create my visual stories because objects can speak in the same way that people speak. Explain what I mean by that. The materials I choose are important to the work. So when you think about objects, we naturally kind of look at them. And what I always tell my students is that all the materials that we have, we look at it and we automatically have a history with it because of the contemporary way we use materials. So I like to take those materials and kind of change the way they look, kind of change the location, the way you're going to receive it, the concept of it, so that the material becomes kind of has its own little life, and it works in a way where the viewer connects with the piece. So I am a very quiet person, and I use these objects to be my voice, my way of communication. And this is the spirit balls, and I'm just in the residency. And what I was trying to do is I have, there's seven sisters in my family. And so I was trying to make a spirit ball for each of them and how it represented them. My work is sometimes cryptic to the viewer. As a sculptor, I use various processes and do not allow myself to be limited by material boundaries. I believe the work should be fluid and of the now, in the same way that stories are different depending on who tells them and when. What I find interesting and what keeps me working is seeing how people connect to my artwork. And this is the House of Four Directions. And I was able, and I was very lucky to get a show in New York at the Smithsonian. And a lot of that work was based on the ideal of memories. So this piece is called House of Memory Court. Where I grew up was in Wichita, this area where all the houses were former Air Force housing places. And they were very temporary homes. They were supposed to be torn down after the war. But instead, many people were migrating to that area of Wichita. And there was a lot of Native people, a lot of Hispanics, a lot of Black, a lot of White. And everyone was of the same low income. And so we all kind of worked together. We all kind of, we all understood where each of us were. So it's based on these kind of stories and these kind of memories that I started developing installation. Installation art is my main focus. And with each piece, I spend months addressing all aspects of the work, time, space, material, location, and objects. Now, audience is real important because I feel like because my work is scripted, I'm depending on you to react to this, the audience. So, and it's interesting to me, and I love hearing how people react to my pieces. And not always in that positive way. I like things to be pretty honest. So detail and subtlety of materials are the most important, as certain materials and images have a more direct relationship to my culture. I have used braided hair, braided horse hair symbolically to represent my tribe's patriarchal system. The braid represents enlightenment. Similarly, the crown represents the messenger and the observer and signifies enlightenment. Self-portraiture has a long history in the arts, and this has been a reoccurring subject in my work since the 1970s. I have presented myself in many different ways by juxtaposing materials and images to give the viewers a hint about myself. Bound objects, surrounded handmade objects to build relationships, and I want my portraits to be real. The house is symbolic of my feeling of containment, and I've used it in a sense in sculptures, as well as paintings and drawings and prints. So when you look at this on the House of Sisters, you can see that, again, I'm using the seven number as because of my seventh, because being of seven sisters. And the first dress that you can see is a little different color, and that one was my favorite dress. I made it out of paper, tried to make it look like the dress I used to wear when I was in fifth grade. Mm. And the Native culture storytelling has an important place in the continuation of history and traditions. My father created a vast memory base for my siblings and me to draw on and learn from. When we gather together, we always tell stories and we always enjoy remembering and laughing and just kind of rehashing our lives. And it's always a, I always enjoy listening to everyone talk. So this is my foundation that influenced me and aids my role as a visual storyteller. The need to tell stories over and over flows from the fact that all of mystery is part of our makeup as a culture and community. It is through storytelling and humor that we are able to connect and relate to each other. And even if there are many different Native people in the community, we continue to connect in a cultural way with each other. There's that similarity and overlap. I find it very interesting. Our humor is such an important part of who we are. By nature, I'm a community-oriented person, and in selecting venues for my work, I look for shows that are part of a Native community, working with other Native artists, and exhibiting in Native venues. It gives me a sense of reconnecting with the people of my culture and of the various artists that are in the Native community. My voice as a Native artist finds a depth and a sense of place as I interact with an audience and find my place among the works of art that deals with the many issues that I find important. This is a piece I did up in Canada, unveiling. And it was a piece that I took a lot of time with. And I had never made baskets before, so I had to work on these baskets and put them together. And I remember my mom came over to my studio at the time, and she was sitting there working on something. And then she looked at my baskets I was making, and she goes, "You know, we do have basket weavers in the community." The way I make things is really kind of raw. It's not pretty, And I like that about it because of that hand. And when I talk about that hand to my students, a lot of that is getting lost today because so many people are so computer-based. Everything's a computer. And so you're losing a lot of, that techniques that we used to learn in school. The diet of most Native people has been negatively impacted by the government programs that dole out processed foods loaded with salt, fat, and sugar. Create a generation of people with heart disease, high blood pressure, and most notably, diabetes. Recently, I've been addressing this epidemic of diabetes in my work as a commentary on how food that Native people eat today is having a negative impact on the future of the community and culture. This health issue is important because diabetes has become widespread in the Native nations. So when I was making this piece, I was thinking about how contemporary traditional food is not really traditional food, but a lot of it has become very deadly. Like when you think about fried bread, boiled in lard, it's like, it's really not good for you, but it's really good. And traditional foods are more nutritional because they were coming directly from the land. There was no fertilizer or genetic changing of the plants. In fact, now seed banks they really hold those original seeds really closely because they're very important. And every once in a while you get to see one of these, plants that you never saw before and the fruits on it, So it's very important that, people kind of remember how we used to eat. More personally, it has been a factor in the health and eventual death of many of my tribal members, family, and friends. The Seminole Diabetes Clinic predicts that one out of every six Native people will develop diabetes. My family history and firsthand experience tell me that the actual number is higher. Today, Native people are re-educating themselves and are changing how they are eaten in order to prevent this disease. But change doesn't come easily. The food has become, traditional, does not sustain our genetics. A lot of times I think about that. I think about how our genetics is really different from other people. It's like with sugar, instead of our bodies reacting to it as sugar, it triples it in our system. So that's why it's become a real factor in the community. So Sugar in Heaven was my first piece based on the sugar issue on crisis. The white veil represents that one in six Natives who is infected with diabetes. And on each one of those chairs, there's a metal plate with a cast sugar heart. And what I would do, torch the heart, and it would just dissolve the sugar, but it looked diseased, because that's what happens with diabetes, it destroys your system. The Last Supper was the second installation I did on the diabetes, and the title double plays with that painting that we immediately think of when we say Last Supper. But it's based on the concept of how a lot of the food that we eat is not good for us. The hospital curtains, which my sister Ruby and they made, it works with that ideal, that place of how the disease has wreaked havoc in our systems, our bodies. So it kind of represents that hospital setting. Each side of the long table are posters that shows the ingredients of my process or processed food and how it's just not good. It's not nutritional. And so when you read that, you start learning how to read those things. And I think it took a long time before I understood what those meant. But the piece is based on just learning and re-educating. So what I did, I casted all these foods, and symbolically they represent that food that we shouldn't be eating. And I casted it in wax, and then I sprinkled on top this crushed glass. And when it's sprinkled on top, it really is sparkly and enticing. It kind of looks like sugar. And so all the different foods are like hamburgers, hot dogs, cakes, donuts, fried chicken, fried bread, and just pastries all over the place. And so it was like the place that you walk in is just kind of like visually attractive and brings you to the place because all the sparkly is good. And then, underneath the table, you see walking canes and mashed potatoes, because that's part of the result of diabetes. This is the entryway for the piece I did at the Smithsonian in Bowling Green, New York. It's called The House of Memory. The whole installation was called. But each segment had a different title. Since I showed you a lot of what I did at Smithsonian, I'm going to kind of focus now on just the cultural landscape. And this is part of that House of Memory. This piece had technology where I had two videos projecting on one side and one video on the other side. And when you walk through the piece, you're kind of confronted with these different parallels. So on one side is the more traditional side or the Oklahoma side. And then on the other side is what's like the Wichita side, more houses. So when we look at the Oklahoma side, I was thinking a lot about how my material has to relate to not just everything about Oklahoma, but my memories of Oklahoma. And I always remember, hearing of all the Waldo's in Oklahoma, which is constant. And it's almost like a bloodline. And then I was also thinking about how our traditions and how our language, our stories, how everything is like in a circle, continuous circle. And so I was relating to that with the continuous book. So I have these four books on these four stands. And when you look at it, you can see how the paper goes from one all the way across to the other. And it's, to me, that sense of continuation, just like as a Native person, I think it's important to remember who we are, where we're from, and just remember that history. So in the piece, I have on one side, one of the things is that will come. And then on the other side, I wanted that to be a little bit more personal. So had my sisters driving all over Oklahoma, and then I had them just help me, with photographs and stuff. So I was able to make videos where it was continuous little images of And the video in Wichita was based on where I used to live in Plainview. And so my sister would drive me all through the neighborhood and just recording how the neighborhood looked. Some parts of it looked the same, and some parts were completely different. It was a little bit more raggier than I remember in my life. But at the same time, you could get a sense of community there. And I thought that was interesting. So when you watch the video, you would kind of go through that my memory lane. And the houses, I always remember the doll houses. In the 50s, there were these metal houses. And so I covered them with paper and then shellacked them. And I always remember when I was a kid, my parents gave each one of us a dollhouse. And what I would do is, like, I could play with, I had a car for my dollhouse, and I could go out and hit my sister's dollhouses. I was kind of honored back then. But nowadays, I think of it, how the dollhouse was a much better house than the house that we actually were living in. And we never noticed that difference, which I think is kind of ironic. So I want to talk a little bit about the piece at the museum, A Force of Nature. And when I think about A Force of Nature, I always think about the strength of the Native community and how we've gone through so many different things and different challenges, but we're still here. And so A Force of Nature kind of represents that sense of continuation. And when I was asked to be in the show, they told me it was a creation show. And I had never done that, and I was really excited. And so I took the creation story of how the clans came about, and how the shell was one of the, where the Great Spirit put all these animals in this shell. And then when the wind came, it would wrap itself around it and was able to break the shell open and the animals would come out. So to me that was kind of, there were certain things about us like that idea of continuation today and, you know, the matriarch of society, the clan system, and how the wind has a big role in it. I'm of the wind clan, so to me it was like important to really play with that idea of wind. When I first kind of started on this piece, I was thinking more in terms of making a big reeded kind of structure, and I felt like that was too, it's like the material wasn't going to work. It wasn't going to have that freedom, that flow I wanted. So I decided to take a big risk because I never worked with screen, and I started ordering screen, buying screen, and just working with it, learning how to make impressions on it. So it ended up being kind of a really nice kind of way of working. There's this nice fluidness in it, and there's also that transparency with the piece. And one of the things I enjoyed Friday was that I like when people are helping me. I like that sense of community. And for the students that were working with me, you know, they really took on a role with the piece. And I loved that because I felt like, you know, it's important that I listen to people and listen to them. And so when they were created that, it was like we were playing around with different ways it was moving, and at one point it looked too thin. So and there was just like this sense of people really working together to create their piece. And I really enjoyed that because, you know, to me, it should be community-based. It should be, you know, I don't think installations are every one person show. There's always people coming to you when you do installations. And I just gotten pretty used to that idea that people will be working with me, people will be, you know, helping me. And to me, it's the thing that I really enjoy, interacting with different museums and different people working with me. And sometimes they come up with an idea and it's, I love it, you know, and I say, okay, let's go with that. So it doesn't really change the way I see the piece, it just enhances it when people know. So. So I got the wind part, and then we started working around the chairs and the shell. And then I was wanted to represent that matriarchal society. And what I did, I took two pictures from my family. And one was my grandmother on my mother's side, and the grandmother on my father's side. And I wanted to put them both in to the piece, because I feel like, you know, the mother of my father, even though it's not, she's not a matriarchal part, but she had a lot of influence on how my dad was raised and how he became who he lives. And on the other side is my grandma, the Duke, and how she, you know, raised my mom. So I'm looking at these things and how there's a continuation. And I don't know if you can see it, but there's a, from one grandma to the next grandma, I was thinking about how I'm not really a good sewer, and the patchwork you have to really be able to sew really well. And so I thought, well, how do I make it mine? So I took these little strips from different sources, and then I made them all black and white so they're all kind of similar. And I made all the different clans and different patchworks, like the Milky Way and Eternal Fire. And I'm using all these strips in eight inches. So there's one after another, where it becomes a continuous strip. And so that, it has different things. So when I look at it, I can kind of read into it, and I can get that sense of pride that some of those have with this type of work. It's pretty tedious, and the more you do it, the more complicated. But I never got that far. My mom, she used to do a lot of that patchwork. So she was helping me at one point in one of the pieces I was doing. And she kept getting mad at me, making me take things out and read to sew it. So I think that's why I decided I had to just go with this one. So you can kind of see the strip on this one. You can see from my grandma, Mommy, there's a little white strip that goes down and then the strip over here. So it's kind of a close in. And the reason why I did the double picture frames is because there's another continuation. There's my grandmother's grandmother, my father's grandmother, and mother's grandmother could be in there. So it's still thinking about how that can continue, and that could, you know, stretch as far back as maybe seven generations. And here's pictures of my grandmothers. Someone asked me today, why do people don't know they're your grandmother? How do they respond to that? And I said, well, they just look like my grandparents. And everyone has grandparents, and how they relate to their grandparents, I go, it's pretty universal. You know? So I said, they're elders, and you can obviously see them, they're native. I said, I don't think I had to put spell it out to kids of my grandparents. I think just by looking at it, you can associate it with your own self. And here's a side view of the way I do mesh. I think when you look at frontwards, it doesn't feel, it doesn't have that appeal. You can see all the waves and all the swirls and stuff, but when you get a side view, you can see how dense it is and how far it comes out. And also, I always like looking at things more three-dimensionally because you get a different kind of take and things right forward. Here's a close-up of the wind. And you can see the on the patterns on the screen, you can see some of the patterns of the swirls and stuff that was created. In the afternoon, we needed to make more legs, so my sister and Megan, they sit down on the floor and start making all these wind shapes so for me. So I was very excited, and they were pretty fast, too. And here's a close-up of the shell. And you can see there's a lightning on it. It's kind of like that fire. And if it burns out there in the shell, it's fine. I wonder if the shell would kind of have that same kind of wind factor, that kind of, because it's something swirling around it. But also, when I think about that shell, I think about that life inside of it. And so I'm thinking about how it breaks open, how things, you know, how the cultures of animals and clans begin. There's a close-up of the beads. And as you can tell, my basket making is pretty freestyle. I like that because I feel like that's my hand. Some idea that it was a lot of fun. So this is my last slide. I just wanted to make a comment that my work as a contemporary Native artist tries to create a place where ideas and questions of life. How do we as indigenous people perceive who we are? And how are we influenced and change people's perception? Why do memories need to be told to others? And what do others gain from sharing of these memories? As an artist, my work is in a constant state of flux. My limited memory of events that occur in the early part of my life and my need to remember them at least part of it. I rely on my sister to tell me a lot of things. That's what kind of drives me to put my work into this, like that sharing. The thing that I hang on to that inspires me when I'm working. Yet I often wonder if there is truth in what I remember of it. Or is it actually someone else's memory that I'm appropriating? And this realization puts me in this constant state of questioning. Because you're always hearing stories all the time of my culture. Story. And I love that, that sometimes I do try to appropriate everything I've learned in my life. But I think by nature, just learning in that way is there's a strong kind of continuous in that. You learn from your past, you learn from your ancestors. And so that really does build quite a memory in you. So this piece was done for all my relations in Minnesota. And again, I was just kind of thinking about house. And I use luggage a lot, old luggage in my work a lot, because there's this sense of how, no matter where we go, we're still carrying things around with us. And, whether it's good or whether it's bad, it's something that we need to take with us. So I made these four pieces where one has a, on the left-hand side, sorry, the picture's not too good. It was a time capsule. And then on the other side was a strong house being held by hands. And then on the other one, there's a tobacco boxes, and then with a little wine that buckled on top. And then I used on the last one, a paper cutter with the heart on it. We are affected by everything that we see and know and have learned and how we respond to that. And I think just allowing yourself to just work with things, that freedom, not worrying about what people are looking, thinking about when you're looking at your work. Not everyone's going to like your work. That's what I always tell my students. But you have to put it out there. You have to make those, take those risks. And that's probably one of the most important things I could tell you myself as artists. Keep working. You know. So we have time for some questions. Anyone have questions?
I'm a student, but no one's going to ask a question. on your frames, on your installation, do we have the photographs out of the frames? What was the what sent you for that? On your installation, where you had pictures of the base, of your frames and your photographs were out, laying there, what was your inspiration
that for that? That was more about how... Now I was trying to explain this to the Smithsonian. How these frames kind of like contain things. But for me, everything's flowing. And when I came with those frames, I knew I was just going to let them stand. And I had the curator here putting those pictures down. And then she started kind of understanding that, you know, even though they're not in a frame like you would see on a mantle, it's things that we could. It used to be a Haskell Institute. And when I got there, it changed to Haskell and then junior college. But I was signed up to be to learn how to make rubber big presses and stuff. And but when I got there, they told me I couldn't do anything but type. And I said, well, why? They go, because you're a girl. You can't do anything but type. So I decided, well, I guess I'll into the arts. And Dr. West, he's a Cheyenne artist, and his work is pretty well known in the arts, and he just kind of took me aside and just kind of nurtured me. So he was my baby.
Okay.
Yes?
How young were you when you started like getting ideas or developing these themes that like later became the shows that you did in the exhibitions? Like, would you say that you've always been drawn to like wanting to depict like your cultural heritages, or did you have to do some trial and error with like other things?
Do
that,
trial and error.
Yeah.
I mean, nothing's ever just smooth.
Yeah.
I mean, artists have to go through all those different kind of changes and drifts, and it's not easy to do. I think also someone asked me, what did I do in those low times when I wasn't having shows? And it's like, I mean, don't even think about those, because I think about how, you know, you're just working hard. You know, I always thought of those times when I didn't have shows, it's like a luxury time, because then you can just really kind of experiment and kind of see what new directions you can go. And you know, for me, it was kind of like one time. Learning how to make videos, and then I was learning how to make sounds. And it's just kind of, use that time, you know, to push yourself and learn things. Okay.
I'm just curious, in general, I know that you teach, so you have a full-time job, right? And how do you structure your time compartmentalize your time, I guess, so that you can continue to make work for those of us who struggle.
Well, I ended up having to make a small studio in my apartment because I would pug. And it's kind of like my kid. So when I go to work, you know, I have to be at work for long stretches of time. So when I come back, to, at least I have this little makeshift studio in my apartment where I can work on things. I just kind of hang around with my dog. But I do have a studio at school. I'm lucky that CU Boulder gives us studios, all the faculty studios. So we all have a studio to work with and work in, and that's, they really want you to work on your art. It's a research school. And they're a lot different than a lot of other schools in the sense that they advocate for their faculty to work on their research. And they have all these different grants for their faculty. So I don't really apply for the grants because most of my materials is secondhand stores. And, you know, if I was making something that I would make drawings for, I'd probably apply for it. But I have this theory, if I can't pick it up, then it's too big. I used to make things and all of a sudden I realized I couldn't get it out of my studio. So I kind of had to make some changes and just let it see life. And I don't know, I've always enjoyed being an artist. It was something that was always around in our family. My sisters used to draw and paint. You know, so it was like my mom being worried. And so there was all these things that happened in our house, and those did other things, and you know, stuff. So it was never that far reached,